So I'm going to be talking about some new work that I've been doing, examining the possibility of using quantum probability theory to say something interesting about human causal reasoning. Just a little bit of motivation for why we want to consider a quantum probability approach to decision making and cognition more generally is that we often see that judgments deviate from classical probability. And most of this work was done by Kahneman and Tversky, where they documented things such as conjunction and disjunction fallacies, base rate fallacies, subadditivity, and the list kind of goes on and on. Well, their work led to the heuristics and biases approach. While this was an influential program and has been able to account for many of these phenomena, its major drawback is that it's not a coherent theoretical explanation for these judgment effects. You have sort of this kind of large grab bag of heuristics, and you sort of say, I'm going to use this heuristic to explain this particular phenomenon and use this heuristic to explain this other phenomenon. And what we would like is to have a single unified theory that can explain many of these different findings. And what I'm hoping to show you today is that maybe the quantum probability theory kind of fills that gap or fills that need for this unified explanation for these judgment effects. So when we're talking about probability theories, most of us are familiar with classical probability theory. This is formalized by Kolmogorov in his book in 1933. So in this theory, we think about events, and those events are described by a single exhaustive sample space, and single events are then subsets in that sample space. Quantum probability is a different approach to probability. We can think of this as a geometric approach to probability. And so here, instead of a sample space, what we have is a vector space. And then we have different bases for that vector space, which can be associated with different sample spaces. So the quantum probability theory allows for multiple sample spaces. I will note that you can have multiple sample spaces in classical probability theory, and Kolmogorov does acknowledge that in his book. But what he doesn't do is tell you how to relate these different sample spaces together. So I can have one sample space and another, but how do I connect those? In quantum probability theory, you allow for multiple sample spaces, and there's a theory about how to connect them. To help sort of motivate this idea of a single versus multiple sample space, let's suppose I come up with some question where I ask you to make a judgment about some future event. This event is going to involve three people. It's going to involve Justin Bieber, Peyton Manning, and Hillary Clinton. Well, you probably don't typically think about these three individuals together ever. And so maybe you don't have a way to form a joint event involving all of these different people. So what you do instead is you sort of break up the problem. And you first think about Justin Bieber, and he sort of lives in this sample space about kind of pop culture things. And you can make a judgment about him. And then you sort of switch your train of thought, and then you think about Peyton Manning, and he kind of lives in this sports-related sample space. And then again, you switch, and now you think about Hillary Clinton in a more political kind of oriented sample space. And so what you're doing is you're sort of thinking about one and then the other and the other, and you have a way of kind of pasting or combining these different individual judgments to form an overall judgment, which is what you report when you ask about this joint probability of these three individuals, which you've never really thought about together before. So I'm going to start by talking about the conjunction fallacy. And this is only to sort of introduce kind of the ideas that I'm going to be presenting later, some of the mathematics. And so I'm going to show this first, and then I'm going to turn and talk about the causal reasoning work. The conjunction fallacy, probably the most famous example of this is the Linda story. So this was work done by Tversky and Kahneman in the early 80s. What they did is they gave participants the following story. The Linda majored in philosophy, was concerned about social justice, and was active in the anti-nuclear movement. And so after participants read this story about Linda, they were asked a couple of questions. They were asked things such as, is Linda a feminist? What's the probability Linda is a bank teller? What's the probability that she's a feminist and a bank teller? And what they found is that most people judge the probability of her being a feminist and a bank teller greater than the probability of her just being a bank teller. And of course, this is a fallacy because in classical probability, we would expect the conjunction to be less than any one of the single events that's making up that conjunction. So this inequality should be turned around, so the probability of bank teller should be greater than the probability of feminist and bank teller. And this finding is fairly robust. They've replicated it in many different situations with different stories, not only about Blinda, but other individuals as well. So in the classical model, what we would have is something where we would be able to form joint events between feminist and bank teller. So we can have events such as she's a feminist and a bank teller, a feminist and not a bank teller, not a feminist and a bank teller, and she's neither. So we have this sort of joint representation of feminist and bank teller, and we can, you know, think about these things simultaneously, and then we assign probabilities to these different joint events. And then when we're asked about one, we just, you know, we can report that. Well, another approach to this problem would be to use the quantum probability theory. And in this case, what we might think is that there are two sort of different sample spaces, so to say, to think about feminist and then to think about bank teller. So we think about one and then the other. And so instead of thinking about them simultaneously, you think about them in a sequence. So you can think about feminist and then bank teller. Mathematically, the way we represent this is in a vector space. I'm going to use a two-dimensional vector space here, but you might think that this lives in a much higher dimensional vector space. So what I have is a two-dimensional vector space where each of my dimensions is associated with the two possible values for feminist. She's either a feminist or she's not. Yeah. Right.
If there's absolutely no contradiction, because given that she's a bank teller, it's more likely that she's a feminist.
Yeah, so they've run a lot of different manipulations, and that's one argument that people have raised. And so Tversky and Kahneman in the original paper, when they were studying these effects, thought about all of these possibilities. And in fact, they would be trying to be very explicit. I mean, they almost told people, look, she's a feminist and she's not a bank teller, or, you know, they tried these different manipulations, and they were very careful about it, and they still get it, even when you really give people all the information. Which, right.
That
could be going on, but they did try to control for that, and it has been replicated by other researchers and other problems who also try to control for these things. I mean, another argument might be maybe they're thinking about an or instead of an and, which has been also something that people have suggested. But again, with sort of the repeated experimentation, the thought is that's not what's going on, but who knows? So the idea here is we have this two-dimensional space, and we're going to adopt one basis for this two-dimensional space that's associated with the feminist question. So we have one dimension, which is the answer kind of, yes, she's a feminist, and one that is, no, she's not a feminist. Those are our two dimensions of our bases. And then we're also going to have another basis in our two-dimensional space, and this basis is going to be associated with the bank teller question. So here I have one dimension, her with no, she's not a bank teller, and the other associated with her being a bank teller. And quantum probability theory postulates the existence of a state vector. So sitting in this two-dimensional space is a vector that represents kind of your sort of initial beliefs about the features of Linda. So maybe given the story about her being, you know, involved in the anti-nuclear movement and she majored in philosophy, you have this sort of prior belief, so to say, about these features of Linda. And now, if I want to calculate the probability of her being a bank teller, what I do is I project the state vector onto the bank teller subspace. So basically, I'm just going to lay this vector down, and then the probability is taking the norm and squaring it, and that's just the probability rule for quantum theory. So now suppose I want to calculate the probability of her being a feminist and a bank teller. Well, I can't calculate them simultaneously. I have to do one and then the other. And so what we hypothesized was that you first think about her being a feminist, because that's more representative of the story that was given about Linda. Linda was, you know, majored in philosophy, active in the anti-nuclear movement. And so feminist is more representative of that story. So what we do is we first project onto the feminist subspace. And then what we do is now our state vector has been updated, and it's lying here on the feminist subspace. And now we project onto the bank teller bases. So we're first thinking about feminist, and then you sort of switch, and then you think about bank teller. And doing this can lead to a larger projection than just projecting directly from the state vector onto the bank teller subspace. So thinking about feminist first somehow makes it more likely that she was a bank teller. Yeah?
Why are feminist and non-feminist different dimensions?
So, I mean, so it's a, I mean, you're either a feminist or you're not a feminist.
Yeah, what's the negative feminist axis, Lisa asked me, and I worry about that too.
So this is all the feminist axis. I mean, it's a single dimension. It's not.
But there's also a non-feminist axis, and they're orthogonal to one another.
Yes.
Is the center zero, or does it go from like negative to feminist and negative to
these are not. So these are not continuous. Mm-hmm. I mean, each of these dimensions is associated with a response. So let's say that I had n responses, then maybe I want n dimensions associated with those n possible things. So if I ask you a question, if she is a feminist or not, then there's only, it's a binary question. And so I'm going to have a dimension associated with each of those different responses, rather than having, you know, the sort of continuum of responses along a dimension. Is that sort of what you're asking?
So therefore, zero means nothing. I mean, where the two lines cross means nothing.
Well, it's not special.
Well, feminist and not feminist axes where they cross, what does that mean? The point of intersection of the feminist and not feminist.
Well, that, so that doesn't really mean anything. I mean, so you have a dimension for each of your responses.
So you've got your state vector.
Yeah.
You
want to
know, you ask, are you a feminist, right? Mm-hmm.
Yes.
They needn't add to one or anything, right?
Well, these are actual amplitudes rather than.
Yeah, these are amplitudes, so they do add to one.
You have them and add them, and therefore, if it is a unit vector, you project it on two orthogonal things.
All these vectors are unit vectors; they can't be shrunk.
Right. So this is a. I mean, this is all unit. So this is a unit length state vector. When I project, I take the norm and I square it to calculate a probability. So the probability of her being a feminist and not a feminist, it sums up to one.
Okay.
Okay.
So, but let's see how this works.
Well, how about I kind of continue with my explanation and maybe, so what I really want to talk about is causal reasoning. This is an introductory example to sort of think about the math. I will point out that this only works if I set up this thing exactly right, and maybe this is what Jeff is trying to get at, is that I would have to be very clever in order to get this to work out in order for the conjunction fallacy to fall out of this. I had to set up this thing so that the angles between the different bases were aligned in such a way and that the state vector is sitting in the space exactly in the right way to get this to work. So this is kind of a shortcoming maybe of this example, but I will mention with this particular conjunction fallacy problem. If you set this up like this, and you can get the conjunction fallacy, what you also get is a disjunction fallacy with the same model. So that's really nice, because that is something that you actually see in the literature, is that people judge the disjunction, so the probability of her being a feminist or a bank teller, to be less than the probability of her being a feminist. So again, that's a fallacy. You would expect the judgment to be the other way around. So you can get that using this model. But once again, I had to sort of, there's a lot of hidden parameters that I'm not showing you here in order to get those findings.
I just want to make sure the data come from two different groups. One group asked one of the questions, another group asked the other one, as opposed to one individual being asked both questions.
Yeah, so with these conjunction this conjunction data, that's usually the case. And some of the experiments I'm going to talk about, we started with some between subject stuff, and then we've more recently done some within subject stuff as well. So I'm going to put off any questions about the conjunction fallacy until the end, because I really would like to talk about the causal reasoning work.
Well, my question was not so much about the fallacy, but the state of the individual. As soon as you ask in your model for a probability judgment, this is a judgment made by a single individual. Right? How do you get the probabilities? How do you get the data?
Do you mean how I get the data out of the predictions out of the model?
Yeah.
Well, I'm projecting the state onto the basis, and I'm squaring it, and I'm taking the norm of squaring.
The subject is reporting a probability in accordance to the projection, the length of that.
Yes, so in the models that I'm going to talk about in a second that I haven't gotten to, the experiments we run is we ask for people to make a probability judgment, and then we are fitting that data to the model where we take, where we project and take the norm and square it.
Yeah, but when you ask what's the probability that the person is a feminist, they project, they report as a result of that projection probability that you write down.
Sure, and we can make this more complicated. We could add a noisy process onto it, say that it's coming from some distribution.
The person is giving you a probability, 0.67, yeah?
Yes.
Now you ask them again, immediately.
Like I said, we could add a noise process onto this.
The model says the number will change from 0.67 to 1.
No, that says if I update the belief, it will. So what you're saying?
You did update the belief.
No, what I did was I didn't actually. So what I did? No.
What your vector running along the x-axis?
So yes. So what I did was I first projected it to feminists. What I didn't do was normalize it at this point. So if I normalize the state, that's like updating and saying now I believe she is a feminist. I didn't actually do that in this model. The picture is not great here. Sorry, my drawings are not perfect in PowerPoint. But what happened was we projected onto feminist. We did not normalize because we only normalize the state vector in situations where we know something to be the case. So if I have a conditional probability where I want to judge the probability of A given B, if I know B has occurred, then what I would do is I would update my state vector to reflect that new knowledge. So at that point, I would project onto whatever B is, that subspace, and I would then normalize my state to reflect that updated knowledge, and then I would project on from there. So that's not what happened in this case, because we don't know that she's a feminist. So what we did was we just projected here, and then we projected there. I think they did this, and they did it with,
They still.
Yeah, so it's really hard to get people not to show this fallacy. So I can't remember all the details, but in their original paper, they have many replications of this, and one of them is basically trying to explain to people what probability theory is, going to graduate students who have taken a stats course and giving them this problem.
If I can, in the one experiment, the subject for statistician. In one experiment, the subject were not exactly statisticians, but they were people
who had some training in statistics.
Yeah, we're professional in statistics. The bias is very strong.
Yeah, I was asking whether it was.
They are supposed to know.
Whether it was just straight out asked.
Yeah.
Whether this is more likely than this.
Yeah.
Or whether the likelihoods were gotten at different times and the numbers were then compared. I haven't seen.
No, they were not probabilists. They were professional statisticians, which is very different. Nevertheless, they got some training in statistics.
Well,
I think you should come
So I'm actually going to turn and talk about something completely different now. This is the new work I've been working on in causal reasoning. That was just a warm-up. We can discuss it more in the question section. But causal reasoning is a really interesting area to research because classical probability theory has been quite successful in modeling elemental causal induction. And this is referring to when you're reasoning about a single cause and effect. People are really good about it. And many of these experiments, what they do is they sort of kind of set it up like you're a mini scientist. So if I inject this gene into this mouse, what's the probability it's going to show some trait? So there's this relationship between the injection of the gene and the trait that the mouse is going to show. And people get really good at sort of, you know, providing probabilities that would almost be like in a contingency table. However, there's also some research showing that judgments about more complex causal systems often violate classical probability theory. And most of this work has been done by Steve Sloan and Phil Fernbach. And they've done this with a range of different problems and different individuals. They've shown sort of fallacies with medical practitioners reasoning about case studies, people just reasoning about future goals, and also individuals reasoning about public policy. So one of their hypotheses about causal reasoning, this is Steve Sloman and Phil Fernbach, is that maybe causal reasoning is structurally local. And their argument is something like this. So when people are asked to think about these more complex causal structures, such as, you know, reasoning about future goals or reasoning about, you know, public policy, what they do is they focus on single causal relationships rather than the full causal structure. So if this is my complex causal structure, which is only two causes and one effect, so not that complex, but let's say I have X and Y and they both cause the effect E. So maybe what people are doing is they think about X and E first, they think about that relationship and they judge that. And then they think about Y and E and they judge that relationship. And then they sort of piecemeal or paste this thing back together to make a judgment about the full causal structure. So they're sort of breaking it up in parts and thinking about one part and then the other, and they're pasting it all back together. Well, this sounds very similar to what you do in quantum probability theory when you're using these multiple kind of pasted together sample spaces. So I'd like to argue that maybe quantum probability provides a way to formalize this structurally local idea, because it's a sort of heuristic idea of saying, okay, I'm going to think about one thing and then the other, and I'm going to sort of paste it all back together. So here, maybe what we have is a sample space for the XE relationship and another sample space for the YE relationship. So in our quantum model, these would be different bases for some n-dimensional space. And I think about one of these relationships using one basis, and then I'm going to switch, and then I'm going to use another basis to think about the other relationship. I'm going to start by describing the experiments, and then I'm going to go back to talk about the models. I think after you see the experiments, it'll make the modeling much clearer. So this was an experimental paradigm that I borrowed from Bob Redder. He's done a lot of work in causal reasoning and categorization, and he's come up with these novel categories in which there are many different types he's come up with. So he's come up with some different biological novel categories, and such as Lake Victoria shrimp. He's also come up with things like novel stars and novel cars. And all of these categories, these objects in these categories, they have different sorts of binary features. And so you can link up these features in different ways to make, in some sense, different causal structures. So I'm going to use the Lake Victoria shrimp that Bob Redder developed. And I'm using three of the binary features that he used to describe these shrimp. So the first one is about the amount of ACH neurotransmitter that these shrimp can have. They can have either a high or a low amount. They can either have an accelerated or decelerated sleep cycle. And they can have a normal or high body weight. So there's three binary features. Now in this experiment, the participants are going to learn that these features are related in certain ways. So there's two causal relationships. So first, the high ACH neurotransmitter can cause a high body weight. A low amount of the ACH neurotransmitter can cause a normal body weight. The second relationship is about the sleep cycle and the body weight. So the accelerated sleep cycle causes a high body weight, a decelerated sleep cycle causes a normal body weight. And so together we've got two independent causes for a single effect, which is the body weight. This experiment and all of the experiments I'm going to talk about involve two stages. The first stage is the same in all of the experiments as a learning stage. And this is just so that participants can learn about these novel shrimp and their features and the relationships between their features. So first, what they do is they learn the three features and the typicality of their values. So they're told this sort of vague information. For example, they might be told that most shrimp have a high amount of ACH neurotransmitter, or some shrimp have a low amount of, or a low, decelerated sleep cycle. After they learn the features, I give them a multiple choice test. This is 6 questions, and they have to answer each question right to go on to the next one, so it sort of forces them to input the right answer to each question. Okay, so after they do the short multiple choice tests, I then tell them about the causal relationships. So I say, okay, well, the ACH neurotransmitter is going to cause, you know, affects the sleep, the body weight, and the sleep cycle also affects the body weight. And I tell them exactly how those relationships are defined. So after they learn that, I give another multiple choice test. This is 8 questions. Again, they have to answer each question right to go on to the next one. Again, so I want to kind of force them to input the right responses at this point. And then I say, okay, well, now I want you to review all the feature information and the relationship information once again. And they do that. And after that, I give them a multiple choice test. This is 10 questions. At this point, I let them respond however they want. And I do this that way I can sort of weed out those people that weren't paying attention and didn't actually learn anything, to kind of look at accuracy here. So in this first experiment, the average score on the final test was 7.8 out of 10. So in general, people are learning the features and the relationships, so this is good. On each of these multiple choice tests, there are 3 possible responses, so this is much higher than chance. Okay, so then that's the first part of the experiment. The second part of the experiment is the judgment stage. So after they've read and learned about this information, they're then asked to make probability judgments about it. And the way that the judgments are asked in this particular experiment is they're asked in a sequence. And we're asking these judgments in a sequence because we're looking for a particular thing, and that is whether or not we see order effects in our responses. So, for example, they might see the following sequence of questions. They might first be asked, what's the probability that the shrimp has a high body weight? And they, during the learning stage, they learned that half of the shrimp have a high body weight and half have a normal, so they should input 50 at this point. And then they're next told, okay, well, we ran some lab test and on this particular shrimp that we caught, and we find out that it has a high amount of ACH neurotransmitter. Now what's the probability that it has a high body weight? And they should have learned during the first stage that a high amount of ACH neurotransmitter can cause a high body weight. So they should increase their judgment from 50 on up to some other number that's above 50. And then finally I say, okay, well, we've ran a few more tests, and now that we learned that the shrimp has a decelerated sleep cycle. And so now what's the probability that the shrimp has a high body weight? Well, they should have learned that the decelerated sleep cycle actually causes a normal body weight. And what you might expect here is that people to decrease the judgment from the previous stage. There are 2 conditions, so this is a between subjects design. The first condition is when participants are always see information about the ACH neurotransmitter first. So in that sequence of questions that I'm asking, if I'm going to talk about, give them information about the ACH neurotransmitter and the sleep cycle, they're going to get the ACH neurotransmitter information before the sleep cycle information. And we're doing this because we're, again, looking for order effects. And if we sort of switched it around and ask people, you know, maybe the ACH second and sleep cycle first, we could possibly, you know, sort of miss out on finding these order effects. The second condition is the sleep cycle first. So they always see information about the sleep cycle before they see information about the ACH neurotransmitter.
I forgot, are they presented with a causal relationship between ACH and sleep cycle, or the other way around?
No, they're not given any information about the relationship between those. So this is similar to what Bob Retter does in his work when he is trying to look at independent causal structures. So we're assuming that that should be an independent, they should be forming a sort of an independent causal structure of the relationships. There are three types of judgments I'm going to ask people. The one would be the prior judgment of the effect. So the probability, let's say, that they have a high body weight, or the probability they have a normal body weight. So the effect is the body weight. A predictive judgment would be, what's the probability of the effect given one or two of the causes? So what's the probability of a high body weight given a high amount of ACH neurotransmitter? And then diagnostic judgments, I flip this around. So I'm asking the probability of the cause given the effect. So what's the probability of the high ACH neurotransmitter given the high body weight? So I'm asking, so these are our two different conditions. So here, they're always seeing the ACH neurotransmitter information first. This group sees the sleep cycle information first. These are predictive judgments. So it's always the probability of the effect given a cause. And our features are binary, so we can think about all the different possible combinations here. And I also switched this around. So now I'm asking, again, probability judgments where the condition one is always the ACH neurotransmitter first, and this is always the sleep cycle first. But here they're asking about the cause given the effects. So the individuals judge these probabilities, and the other group judges these. Yeah?
When you tell them about the causes singly, do you say that this causes this irrespective of the other things, or do you just say this causes it?
I say this causes this, and then I give a short explanation of why that would be. That's
so
all the information.
They're supposed to assume that these are the causes or something like that, right?
One would think, so I'm going to get to this question.
The world isn't always like that.
Well, right. So I'm going to come back to that point later in a different experiment. But yeah, I'll come back to it. So what we're looking at is order effects. So let's say, for example, the probability of the high body weight given, let's say, high neurotransmitter and decelerated sleep cycle, does that equal the probability of the high body weight given the decelerated sleep cycle and the high ACH neurotransmitter? So if I just sort of switch the order in which I told them the results of these lab tests that were run, does it affect their final judgments? And so these are the results. What you're looking at is the four different plots showed some of the four different combinations of features. For example, we can have high ACH neurotransmitter and accelerated sleep cycle, high ACH and decelerated sleep cycle, low ACH, accelerated sleep cycle, low CH, decelerated sleep cycle. Those are what the four different plots mean. And then this is the prior judgment of the effect before they're given any information or any lab test results. This is after the first cause that they see, so after the first set of lab results. And this is after the second set of lab results. The red is showing the ACH first group. The dotted blue line is the sleep cycle first group. And what we're looking for is the final judgment. So these judgments after both causes have been presented. If we don't see an order effect, then those judgments should be roughly the same. And in some cases, they are, such as in this plot here and in this plot here. However, when the features are mismatching, so when one feature sort of points towards the cause, such as the high body weight, and one is pointing away from the cause, let's say like the decelerated sleep cycle, you see quite a large order effect. And that's in these two plots here. So we also looked at the diagnostic judgment results. And what you see is kind of what you would expect. So something that's a bit more classical or kind of correct in some sense. So again, you're looking at the two different values of the features. So, you know, high ACH neurotransmitter and accelerated sleep cycle, et cetera, for the four plots. And this is after the first judgment. So this is the probability of one of the causes given the effect. And this is the second one, the probability of now both of the causes given the effect. And we don't see really any effects here. So no order effects. All of these judgments are more or less the same, which is interesting. So you kind of see this, you see order effects and these predictive judgments, which is not surprising. This we've found similar sorts of results in other causal reasoning situations and also other inference types of problems. We don't see it here in the diagnostic judgments. I will point out that some of the work that Steve Sloman and Phil Fernbach have done have been looking at predictive and diagnostic judgments, and what they actually find is many of the violations occur in predictive judgments and not in diagnostic judgments. So this sort of reflects that as well. I'm going to come back to this point about the diagnostic judgments in the second experiment, but I'm going to turn to talk about the modeling now. So when we think about the models, we could have a model in which we assume that they can form a joint representation of all of the possible features and their values. So they can think about the body weight, the neurotransmitter, and the sleep cycle simultaneously, and they can assign probabilities to these eight joint events that occur from all different possible combinations of the binary features. So this is one possibility. Another possibility is they sort of break this problem up along the relationships that they've learned. So they're told that there are two relationships, that the sleep cycle can cause affect the body weight, and also that the neurotransmitter can also affect the body weight. And so maybe what they're doing is, instead of forming this joint representation over all of the eight possible joint events, they sort of break up the problem in this kind of idea of the structurally local concept, and they think about one relationship and then the other. And so what this gives you is two sets of four events. So you can think about the effect and one of its causes and all the possibilities there, and the other effect and the other cause and the effect, and gives you another four events. So maybe this is another way people are approaching this problem, is to sort of break it up and sort of paste it back together in some sort of way. Well, you could break up this problem even more. Instead of thinking along the relationships, you could break it up and only think about the different features. So maybe you only think about sleep cycle or body weight or the neurotransmitter, and you don't try to think about any of them simultaneously. You just think about one and then the other and then the other. So you just, when I ask you a question, you just sort of switch your train of thought and move between them. And this gives you three sets of elementary events. So we have elementary events associated with, say, the neurotransmitter, the sleep cycle, and the body weight. So this gives us three kind of classes of models. So over here we have an eight-dimensional representation, and this is essentially, we can call this a classical model, because we have a single exhaustive sample space for all of our eight different joint events. And so this maps nicely onto classical probability theory. We have a four-dimensional representation. This we can think about as a more quantum-like model, because here we have two sample spaces and we have to relate them somehow. We do that through, you know, rotations in this vector space. And then we have a two-dimensional representation, which is using three different sample spaces and then rotating between those. So we have kind of our one classical model and then two different possible quantum models. I'm going to talk about more details about the quantum models, and we'll start with a two-dimensional model because it's easier to explain, because I can show you a picture. So what we think is that maybe when you're thinking about one of these features, let's say the effect, the body weight, that is represented by a bases for a two-dimensional space. So one of my bases is the effect is present, the other is the effect is absent. If I then switch and think about the ACH neurotransmitter, I'm representing that by a different basis for this two-dimensional space. So I have that the ACH neurotransmitter is present, or it can be absent. And the way that I get this basis is by rotating from the bases of the effect. So what I can do in this model is I can affix one of the bases and then define the others in relationship to it. And so I'm going to point out I'm using all reals in this model, so it is just in R2. And here it's a simple rotation matrix that I'm applying to the E bases to get the X bases. So there is a free parameter here, and that's that theta that I will be fitting to the data. Now, to get the bases for the sleep cycle, again, that's going to be some rotation of my E bases. So again, I'm going to have a free parameter that's associated with that rotation. So far, I have a rotation parameter for the X bases and a rotation parameter associated with the Y bases. So that will set up the relationships between these different bases in my two-dimensional space. The quantum model also postulates the existence of a state vector that sits in this space. And I want to make as few assumptions about this as possible. So what I do is I allow this these coordinates of where this state vector is sitting to be free parameters as well. So again, the state vector has to be unit length. So the norm squared has to add up to 1, which means if I know one of these, then I can figure out what the other one should be. And so what we do is we allow one free parameter, and that's alpha 1, and then we define alpha naught in terms of that.
Are you working over the reals or the complex numbers?
The reals. So this is all of the modeling that I'm going to talk about is only in the reals. So what I've tried to do is make as few assumptions as possible about what the rotations are and where the state vector is sitting, and I'll just fit it all and see what falls out. So let's suppose that I want to now calculate a probability. So the probability of the effect given one of the causes, let's say X1, where X1 is the ACH neurotransmitter, that it's a high amount. So what I do is I first take my state vector and I project it onto the X1 subspace. And then what I do is I normalize that state vector because I know X1 is true. Like they said, I ran a lab test. I found that it has a high amount of ACH neurotransmitter. So that information is new information. I update my state to reflect that new information. And so now my state is sitting along this X1 basis. Then it's unit length. And from there, I then project on to the E1 subspace. And after that projection, I take the norm and I square it, and that gives me my probability. And so you can think that for whatever questions I ask you, any sort of conditional probabilities, I just project the state vector in the appropriate sort of way and normalize when I'm conditioning on something, and then take the norm and square when I want to calculate a probability. So this two-dimensional model has three free parameters. It has a rotation parameter for the X basis, a rotation parameter for the Y basis, and this alpha 1, which is the location of the state vector. So the four-dimensional model, again, I'm going to try to make as few assumptions.
That model can't show order effects, right?
Yes, it can.
Okay. I'm surprised only because the parameters are all angles, and the rotations commute. So that in what order you decide to rotate doesn't matter.
So if I want to look at an order effect, the probability and effect given one cause and then the other versus the other way around, you can get order effects out of this model. And I will show you. So it has to do with projecting and when you normalize.
The projections.
Yeah. So for the four-dimensional model, again, I'm trying to make as few assumptions as possible exactly what the rotations are and where the state vector is located. It's a bit more tricky with a four-dimensional model, so I have to make some assumptions. But I'm going to start with two bases. So these bases are for a four-dimensional space. One base is associated with the joint events associated with one of the causes and the effect. So let's say the ACH neurotransmitter and the body weight. And the other bases is associated with the other cause, so the sleep cycle and the body weight. And so these are the rotations that I'm currently using. I'm open to other suggestions. And what this is, so I'm multiplying these three different rotation matrices together to get my single rotation matrix that I'm applying to, let's say, this basis to get that one. And there's three free parameters associated with each of these matrices. And essentially what this is doing is rotating in sort of two dimensions at a time. So for example, this first one is rotating the first two joint probabilities and the second. So it's rotating, sort of thinking about x1 in some sense being fixed, and this is also x0, and so it's rotating.
Well, in fact, what you're doing is right. If you have three dimensions, you're rotating around an axis. When you get four dimensions, you're rotating around two axes. And what happens is that's what you captured right here in terms of you take a look at the first one, and that means you're rotating around the z-axis type thing in the other one. So that's exactly what happens.
Right. So we're trying to break this up, and because there are many more rotations that you can do in four-dimensional space. And so one of possible for future work is to then go back and look at other rotations. But we started with these because it actually matches nicely on to kind of the structure of the problem to break it up in these kind of fixing one direction and rotating around the others. So this gives us three free parameters in these rotation matrices. And then we also have to think about the state vector and its location, and that gives us another three parameters because it's a four-dimensional space. And again, it has to be unit length. So the fourth coordinate of that state vector is determined by the other three. So in the eight-dimensional model, we're going to have a single basis. We're not going to rotate at all. And so this basis is going to be associated with these eight joint events. So there are no rotations. And there's seven free parameters to define the location of the state vector. So we have an eight-dimensional space, and we have some state vector sitting in that space. Again, we want to make minimal assumptions about what that is. So you can use seven free parameters, and against unit length, so the eighth one is determined by the others. Well, actually, we can, so that is sort of a very unrestricted way to generalize the eight-dimensional model. And we can actually restrict the parameterization by using models that have already been suggested in the literature, such as causal power. So this is Patricia Cheng's model. And what we do in this model, what is assumed is that each cause has a power parameter W. And this is the thought to represent the power that a cause has to bring an effect into occurrence. This model also allows for unknown alternative causes. So you could have some other background causes besides the two that I defined. So besides the ACH neurotransmitter and the sleep cycle, maybe there's some other alternative causes that are occurring. And so we allow for those to have some power to cause the effect. So that's the WA parameter. And then conditional probabilities are calculated by a noisy OR, which is given here. And using this noisy OR and along with prior probabilities of the causes, we can define each of the joint probabilities. So the probability of, let's say, x1, e1, and y1. And that's given by this formula here.
Where j and k are 0 or 1, right?
That's right. So j and k are 0 or 1. Thank you.
15 minutes.
OK. Yeah. So what we do is we associate the coordinates of the state vector with the joint probabilities from causal power. And then we can do this so that when we project and take the norm and square it, it would be the probability from causal power. So essentially, we sort of embedded causal power into this geometric framework, and that's just so that we can, you know, have a geometric representation of all of our models. So the causal power model has fewer parameters than this unrestricted eight-dimensional model. It has the three power parameters and then two prior probabilities. So this gives us a total of four models that we're going to be looking at. We have a two-dimensional model, a four-dimensional model, and then two versions of the eight-dimensional model, this unrestricted classical kind of model with seven free parameters, and that's determining the location of that state vector, and then the classical model with five free parameters, which is causal power. So we're fitting the models to the mean judgments. So there were a total of 40 mean judgments. Each condition, they provided 20 judgments. And so together there were 40 judgments. And so we fit the model to those mean judgments by just sort of minimizing the sum of squared error between the model and the data. And then we, because all of our models have different number of parameters, we calculated a BIC for each of the models. So they all do all right. The two-dimensional model actually seems to do best in terms of the BIC in this particular situation. But we'll point out that the other models are also doing all right. So if we want to just think more about, instead of a quantitative fit, but a qualitative analysis of the data, a classical model, so these eight-dimensional models, whether it's unrestricted or causal power, cannot produce order effects, whereas both of the lower-dimensional models, so the two-dimensional and four-dimensional models, they can produce order effects.
Is that because of the number of variables you have? Number of added variables you have for modeling?
That they're able to produce order effects?
Yeah.
It has to do...
Because you're already twisting everything around according to your data. I would be surprised with eight dimensions.
That with eight dimensions that I...
With eight dimensions, with the number of variables that are involved.
It has to do with the structure of the problem. In order to get the order effects, you have to have some rotations in the model. So in this eight-dimensional model, this sort of classical model, you don't have any sort of rotations, and so everything commutes. Right, so in these lower dimensional models, if I want to calculate the probability of, let's say, the effect given one cause and then the other, there has to be a rotation between calculating the probability of the first effect and the second effect, and that occurs in both of these models. It does not occur here, because we're fixing one basis for that space. But, I mean, if we remember back to the data, there were only a few order effects in the data, right? So. You know, not all of the data has this sort of signature to it. And so that would explain maybe why we're seeing that overall most of the models do okay. The two-dimensional model is sneaking ahead a bit in terms of BIC. So I want to quickly talk about experiment two and then move on from there. So you might ask, okay, well, these order effects, this is interesting, but perhaps they just don't remember the information. You ask about one judgment, and then on the next screen, you give them new information. They just forget what was on the previous screen. And so what you're looking at is really a memory effect and has nothing to do about how people are rotating and thinking about information. So we've run two variants of this first experiment. The second experiment here that I'm going to show you is where we remind them of the information that they just saw. So let's say in the final judgment, the probability of judging the effect given both causes, I would say something like, lab tests show that this shrimp that you already learned has a high amount of ACH neurotransmitter also has a decelerated sleep cycle. What's the probability that it has a high body weight? So in that last question, they're reminded and given that information that they already saw. We've also done this where we keep all the information on the screen, so you get question one, question two, question three. It doesn't seem to matter. The results look pretty similar. Again, you get order effects in the situations where the causes sort of mismatch. So when they're pointing in sort of different directions, you get the order effects. And when they don't, you don't. So it's not a question about memory. because we're, the information is sitting right in front of them. They don't have to remember anything to make these judgments. What's actually really interesting is you get very different results in the diagnostic judgments when you set the problems up like this and you remind people of information. So before, if you remember, what happened is we didn't get any order effect here in the second judgment. So these kind of collapsed to the same point. Now they're not. But it's interesting because the models can actually account for this. And so what we do in this task, and so what they're told at this second judgment is, they've already said, what's the probability of a cause given the effect? And then the second judgment would be, what's the probability of the other cause? And then they're told about the information of the effect again. So given that the shrimp has a high body weight, now what's the probability of the other cause? So they're sort of reminded of that information about the effect after, along with each question. So they're told the effect at each point when they're asked to make a judgment. So in the model, if we project back onto the effect subspace and then project onto the cause, we get exactly this pattern in the data. So in the first experiment, we would have said something along the lines. The first question would have been, a shrimp was caught, some lab tests were run, it has a high body weight. What's the probability it has an ACH, high amount of ACH neurotransmitter? On the next screen, it would then say, what's the probability that it also has a decelerated sleep cycle? Second experiment is, shrimp is caught, has a high body weight, what's the probability of high ACH neurotransmitter? Second question is now, what is the probability of the shrimp with the high body weight of having a decelerated sleep cycle? So we restate the information about the effect again at the second question, and that provides very different results in the data. So you don't see the sort of convergence onto that single point. So in all of these models, you can get this if you sort of project back onto the effect. So it's almost like they're rethinking about the effect, so they project back on the effect, and then they project onto that final cause, and it produces this pattern. All right, so what we did here is we didn't refit the models. We used the best fitting parameters from the first experiment to then see how well the models generalize for the second experiment. So in terms of GCM terminology, we used experiment one as the calibration data and experiment two as the generalization data. Again, we're going to, in all of these models, project back onto the effect in the diagnostic judgments. Since that was a difference in the experiment. So overfitting in the calibration stage can lead to poor generalization. And what we find, so here I'm looking at just the mean squared error between the data and the model. This is using, again, the best fit parameters from the first experiment. And the two-dimensional model, again, works really well. What you actually see is the four-dimensional model, it's overfitting because it's missing a bunch of things in the second data set, which is actually interesting. When I set all of this up, I thought the four-dimensional model was going to work, and I was surprised that it turns out to be the two-dimensional model that seems to do all right. I mean, causal power is doing okay, too. It's really not that much of a difference. Because of that, we started running some more experiments more recently to look at very precise predictions from the two-dimensional model and see whether or not they hold up, because this two-dimensional model makes some very interesting predictions about dependencies that maybe we wouldn't expect to be there, as was already discussed. And also, recently, we just finished this experiment last week, but there are also some invariances that this model predicts that we're also testing as well. So in terms of dependencies, when we fit this model, what we find is that the parameters between the x and the y bases are very similar, so they're almost the same. What this means is that when people think x is occurring, they also think y is also occurring. So what this should imply is that the probability of x1 given y1 should be greater than the probability of x1 given y0. If we want to see this in the picture, if our state vector is sitting here and we project onto y1 and normalize and then project onto x1, it's a really huge projection. However, if we do it the other way and project onto y0, normalize, and then project onto x1, it's a very tiny projection. Causal power, on the other hand, is going to predict that they're independent. that the probability of x1 does not depend at all on the probability of y, or what the value of y is.
Yeah. Can you do it in about 5 minutes?
Yeah,
minutes?
I'm almost done.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think that's related to the problem of gimbal lock, where you have two axes that line up when you're doing one of the rotation, and then you'll lose 1 degree of freedom because you end up with collinear axes in computer graphics. That's probably why you lose that information.
Yeah, so this model could have fit so that there was a 45 degree angle between.
Right, and then when you do a projection, yep. You project onto the origin and you have no information.
Yeah, so, right, exactly. So this is very much a prediction that comes out of the way the model was fit to the earlier data. So this is a within subjects experiment to test these dependencies between causes. The instructions in learning stage are identical to the other experiments. And then we asked them to judge conditional probabilities. And these were things such as we had these to test dependency, so probability of one cause given the other cause and all possible values of the features. And then we also threw in some predictive judgments of, well, the probability effect given one of the causes. So here we're not looking at order at all, just conditioning on one thing. So I'm going to call a match something where the feature values match, so they sort of point to the same direction of the effect. So let's say a high ACH neurotransmitter accelerated sleep cycle both cause a high body weight, so that would be a match, whereas a high ACH neurotransmitter and decelerated sleep cycle would be a mismatch. And you do see this dependency. So people are judging the probability of things that match to be greater than things that mismatch, which is more in accordance with the quantum model than it is with the causal power model. This is just we fit the model to the data, and we fit it to the individuals. But what you're looking at is the mean model predictions by the mean judgments and the correlation there. The data is pretty noisy, and so this provides a better representation visually of it. But what is really interesting is then we actually looked at fit by BIC for the different participants. And what you're looking at is the difference in matching versus mismatching conditional probabilities. So people that have a high positive bar here are showing that sort of dependency that's predicted by the quantum model, and those that are not, that would be more like causal power. So the model was fit to not only the dependency data, but also to the predictive judgment, so the probability effect given the one of the causes. And what you're looking at is we're picking the best model per individual based on BIC. And so not everyone is like the two-dimensional model. In fact, we have some people that are very classical. There were at least three people in this data set who provided exactly the same judgments for the probability of, let's say, X1. It doesn't matter what you conditioned on. They got it just right in some sense. And they looked very much like causal power, whereas other people looked a bit more two-dimensional quantum, if you want to say. I'm going to sort of, there's a lot of future directions here. I'm not going to get into it because I'm over time, but basically we can look at different causal structures. Maybe if you have a chain of causes or two conjunctive causes, so both have to be present to cause the effect. We want to look at different tasks. Do they generalize? Is this just something special about shrimp, or can we do this, let's say, in a perceptual domain? Do we get these types of phenomena? Can we account for these individual differences? Is there some sort of personality test or something that we could give that would maybe provide some information about that? And can learning and experience lead to more classical behavior? So some people already look classical. Can we get other people to look a bit more classical as well if they're trained more? There wasn't that much learning in this task at all. They weren't trained on probabilities. They were just given some kind of vague information about the relationships between features, and that's all that they had. But if they had more specific information, would they look more classical? So I want to acknowledge my collaborator, Manuel Pathos at City University, and the members of the JDM lab here at UCI, and also NSF for their support. Thank you. Yes?
We can handle a few questions, even though we're a little over.
Well, so I probably you got this question already from someone else, but listening to you, I mean, this is very interesting. Obviously, new ideas, new approaches. but I couldn't help ask this question to myself. You know, that so basically you look at this people's probability judgment given the numbers, 0 and 1. But how do you know that people's probability judgment is actually a probability in the sense of Kolmogorov probability or quantum? Or maybe just it's not a probability. It's just a completely different thing. That's the first question. Second related question, you're talking about this vector space and projection. But how do you know that even if people's probability judgment is some sort of probability, but how do you know it's actually vector space? Maybe not form of vector space. Maybe it's a different space. So you haven't checked those things. Because you just assume that judgments are probability and it's a form of vector space. But we talk about the psychological space, not the physical space, quantum space. Or that these are probability, these are vector spaces, for example. But you have to check those sort of founding assumptions.
The second question has to do with just finding more models and testing them. And so I think this is always a problem for any field in psychology. You can always define more models, and that's perfectly fine. I'm happy to come up with as many more models as we can to test them. I tried to come up with several here that I thought were reasonable to start with. So that's kind of, I mean, it's an issue not only for this work, but a more general issue in psychology is, you know, when have we kind of found as many appropriate models as we need? So I agree with you, that is something to think about. And as I mentioned, maybe we want to look at other even models that are in these class of models, so other four-dimensional models maybe would work better. And so that's something we can explore. The first question, so this work is, you know, sure, probability judgments may not be, you know, probabilities that, you know, in terms of Kolmogorov sense. But we're sort of looking at those judgments in the same way that they've been treated in other kind of causal reasoning domains. And so I think that's not only an issue for this work, but, you know, it's a problem for causal power, it's a problem for, you know, delta P and all of these different methods. And so in some sense, we have to say, okay, yeah, we need to do more work and we need to understand, are people's judgments, are they really probabilities, are they not? But at the same time, I mean, we have to sort of look at trying to advance the models too while we are still trying to answer these more fundamental questions. Yeah.
Kahneman and Tversky made the point in several papers that if you frame some of these problems in terms of frequencies rather than probabilities, that the funny effects are greatly diminished. Not all of them.
Right, not all of them.
Not everywhere, right? But it makes a big difference. And then Gigerenzer.
Yeah, so
said that it was his idea and so on. But you could ask frequency.
We could, and I think that's actually a really good point. So this work is not to say the quantum model is the end-all be-all. What it is actually saying is under certain experimental tasks and under certain response modes, people's behavior looks a bit more like this quantum-like model. Let's suppose I change the task. Let's suppose I change the response mode. Now what does it look like? I think that's actually very valuable because if we change this and it looks more like frequency, if we change it to frequencies and it looks, and we suddenly, causal power now does so much better. That's really interesting because it tells us a way to sort of, again, it's sort of reinforcing this debiasing idea of how to debias people, but it's also now giving us a formal framework for showing how that's done. So I agree with you. I think that first, we know that not everybody looks, you know, like this two-dimensional quantum model. We have people that look very classical, so it's sort of understanding why that happens and under what situations do you see the more kind of quantum behavior and which ones do you not. And I think you're exactly hitting the nail on the head when you say it's frequency judgments, probably not so much. Yeah.
Just wanted essentially to preempt Jeff Iverson's question, but I'm going to ask what he probably would have asked you. And maybe it's a bit more of a comment. I'll try to make it very succinct. You see, in a sense, the main task that you are facing is to convince people outside psychology that it's not purely metaphorical, that there is something here that is not just based on superficial analogy between quantum mechanical formalisms and something that you observe in psychological experiments. And the way you are presenting it actually begs certain questions from the very beginning that prevent people from appreciating, you know, the intricacies of your analysis of specific experimental data. And here is what I mean.
when you take these electrons that are running away from each other and you are measuring their spins, you are asking a question, what's your spin? And the electron answers up or down, let's say, if it is electron. It doesn't say probability is 0.5 or 0.7 or 0.9. If it sets so, then from a physicist's point of view, you have to set up an infinite dimensional space in which there would be these answers would be eigenvalues of something extremely high, right? So since the responses in your experiment are probabilities, then it means that if you are using quantum mechanical analogy, they should be the eigenvalues with infinite number of eigenvectors, and you have to use infinite dimensional space for that.
Well, I'm not trying to do anything with quantum mechanics here. So I'm trying to not say anything about the physics, right? So I want to have just a different type of probability theory. I don't know why we have to try to tie that so much to the physical, the physics.
No, but this is the essence of quantum mechanical formalism, right? So that the things that you are measuring are eigenvalues, eigenvectors, and the probabilities are squared eigenvalues.
But why does that need to?
If you're not using this, this basic principle of the formalism, then it becomes too metaphorical, right? But you can, I didn't mean it really as kind of dismissive criticism. I meant that you have to make some additional assumptions, and you have to stipulate them in the beginning. Something to the effect that, the estimate of probability corresponds to the situation in which infinite number of electrons would be answering yes or no, and
I
something
see,
like
I disagree.
That.
So, my interpretation of this is the only thing quantum about this is that this probability came out of quantum mechanics. I could have called this projective geometry probability theory. I could have made up a different name for it. But it's also kind of a lie of omission because it does come out of the quantum mechanics, but that's sort of where it ends. So I've got a new probability theory, and for me, I don't need to tie it down to the physics as much. We can disagree about this, but that is at the level that I'm thinking about it.
Let me. Let me put things slightly differently. What is the underlying mechanism for the variability in the data that you actually observe? You try your best to prepare everybody in the same state.
Right, so I can extend this model and
the probabilities that you elicit from these people are deterministic.
But this is the same for this is the same for causal power. So, we have to think, I'm comparing kind of these high-level probability models.
The question is very simple. What? So, in the analogous physical experiment, where you're dealing with particles with properties, measurable properties, that turn out to be the eigenvalues of operators in typically infinite dimensional spaces. Here, you would be measuring a proportion of individuals who say one thing or the other to a dichotomous question, but that's not the form of your data. It's like asking an electron who's in a mixture, who's in a superposition of states, to give you the amplitudes. There's nothing the electron can do.
But why does it, why do we have to tie this framework to the physics in that sense?
But then I ask you, what is producing the variability in the data that you observe? It's not coming from the mechanism. You have to impose it somehow.
Sure, but that would be the case for any of these style of models. I feel like that argument applies yes to these quantum models, but it applies equally well to causal power, it applies the same to these delta P models.
You have a theory that gives you a deterministic That is, once you've got your subject from an initial state that you pretty much tell everybody you ought to be in, if they're living in that particular vector space of that particular dimensionality. So you tell the people, half the shrimps are heavy and half are not. You tell them that. They know where to begin by your own instructions. And now the mechanism takes over. Now you start rotating from one basis to another. What produces variability in the response of different individuals? They're all, according to your theory, described exactly the same way.
Well, again, we can extend this model to account for variability in similar sorts of ways as you would extend the other classical probability models that I'm talking about.
Having nothing to do with quantum ideas at all.
But why would it need that? Why can I not have a quantum model that then says my mean response is coming from my quantum model, but there's some distribution around it because people give noisy responses. So there's noise in the response mechanism.
And that is extra quantum. That is outside. Right.
I don't see why that's wrong. Because that's a similar sort of thing that we do with other models in psychology, is we say we have some system that's going to produce.
The number of parameters has exploded. It's not 3 or 5 or whatever. It's every subject, let's say, even if they start from the same initial vector, and that could be made variable, the position of these different vector spaces varies from one individual to another.
Sure, and you know, one of the things we...
How many parameters you got?
Well, it depends on how you define the problem, right? So, one of the things I would like to do in the future is actually implement this in a Bayesian framework, so to fit the model. So then I would have a distribution on all of these parameters. And that's something that can be done. And it's very similar to how you would fit any other model in psychology in some sense, right? Because we have parameters, we assume that there's some noise around what those parameters are. We have some distribution of belief about what they are. Maybe people have individual differences, which we started to hint at here at the last experiment. Because I agree with you, not everybody has the same parameters, and we're trying to develop within subjects experiments to fit individuals. And then we would like to sort of move into better fitting methods as well, so using a more Bayesian framework to fit this, which allows for this sort of variability. But again, this is outside the quantum model. And for me, I don't see why that has to be such an issue. Because again, this model is not saying anything about electrons and or anything about that. It's just using this geometric framework to calculate probabilities. And it just so happens that this framework kind of comes out of quantum mechanics.
Jeff, some of what you were saying, it seems to me, could also be said of all these experiments of choice among gambles, where people calculate the utility according to certain things. Maybe 70% of the people pick this gamble over that gamble, and yet the model is predicting exactly what the utility should be. Kinds of stuff that Duncan does with gambles that doesn't have any theory.
Other models do not say that it is quantum formalism. You see, quantum formalism should have some meaning kind of close to the original meaning. And the problem is that on the most basic level of what inputs are, what outputs are, you are deviating from that. You see, have inputs, outputs, and probabilities of outputs.
I think we have a fundamental disagreement about how this mathematics should be used. So I think that you can take mathematics that was originated in some other area and use the mathematical constructs in a way and apply it to a different problem without bringing along that baggage. I mean, we do this all the time in psychology. I mean, this diffusion model is a great example of this.
Example of what?
We're just taking a physical model and putting it into psychology, right? So, I mean, in some sense, you know, we have a mathematical idea that was developed around something physical, and that mathematics now provides us with a tool that we can use for other problems. So I sort of see this as more of a philosophical issue about the use of the mathematics.
It's like simulated annealing. Simulated annealing was developed to train neural networks, but it's based on a physical process of cooling a physical substrate slowly over time to create a certain molecular structure within it, like steel or something like that. I have one more question.
Sure.
I wanted to know if you've ever used the quaternion, done studies on quaternions, because you could avoid the issue where you have orthogonal bases to one another over your projection, you lose information. Because if you get away from the Euler rotation model, and you start using quaternions, instead of defining rotation around a particular between orthogonal, you actually create a unique axis for that one rotation, and you have an extra free variable, which is the angle around that axis, and you'll avoid that issue of getting gimbal lock and losing a rotation when you're stacking them.
And the same thing with the eight-dimensional models.
Yeah, and it's interesting because if you one way to develop the quaternion rotation is that you can compose it out of Euler rotations, and it actually combines all three of those rotations in the one rotation. So maybe what's going on in the eight-dimensional model, where people don't show any kind of order effects, they're actually using a quaternion rotation, which basically allows you to compose those rotations in any order because you have an arbitrary axis around which you're rotating.
Yeah, that, I haven't thought about that, but that's a really good idea. Maybe we can talk more about it.
I have one more question. I'm sorry. I raised my hand earlier.
Sorry.
In the case of the Linda experiment, mm-hmm. and other experiments like that, the name conjunction fallacy was extremely well chosen. It's a fallacy of the theory of probability.
Mm-hmm.
Which means that the people, I think in the mind of Tversky, that the people receiving this question don't interpret them as a conjunction. Now, if you think about, you're told that Linda is a backteller and that she's a feminist and they have to estimate what the probability is. They might think, what do I know? I mean, she's a bank teller. Now, what's the probability that she's also a feminist? Meaning, they may very well, if they have not a very good training in probability, interpret it as a condition of probability, in which case you get the fallacy.
It's almost a
and the variability between the subject may come from how much probability they know.
Sure. So I think there are many different kind of explanations out there for the conjunction mm-hmm. fallacy. And I just read a recent paper in, I can't remember, but it was actually looking at a more Bayesian interpretation of it, where you're talking about sort of strength of the relationships between things, and they can provide a very classical explanation for all of this. So I do think something else can be going on in the conjunction fallacy.
But you can test the what I'm proposing can be tested, because you can train some subject. Doesn't take that much time, and explain to them what condition probability and conjunction is, independently of anything, free of anything. Then you perform the task.
Yeah. If you explain the nature of the conjunction fallacy and how it violates,
no, you don't do that.
If you teach people that fallacy disappears.
Thank you.
All right.